This episode of The Totally Rad Show is brought to you by Jack Threads. Coming up, director Rian Johnson brings us the time travel action film, Looper.
Today in movies, we are talking about Looper from one of TRS's favorite directors, Rian Johnson. We loved Brick and Brothers Bloom. This is his third movie. And although I'm sure you're loving his episodes of Breaking Bad, everyone seems to love them. I'm not watching. We are not watching.
Yeah. Some of the most interesting episodes of Breaking Bad.
Right. Did he write them and direct them or just direct them?
No, just directed them.
Interesting though.
But yeah, you can tell.
Yeah. It's a very distinct style, and for the first time we're seeing that applied to an action movie, to a science fiction movie set in the near future where time travel exists. Bad guys from the future send bad guys back in time where loopers are gonna kill them so that that bad body doesn't exist.
Yeah.
The movie kicks into high gear when Joseph Gordon-Levitt's character is sent or is faced with a future version of himself to kill.
Bruce Willis.
But all, played by Bruce Willis. But all hell breaks loose. That is Looper.
Hunting his past, hunted by his future.
Yeah.
A
future more akin to Children of Men, or even recently, Unity but Judge Dredd. Not big and production designy like Total Recall or other movies this summer. Very much like it's now with a little bit of touches here and there.
Yeah.
And has Rian Johnson's very distinct camera work. Alex.
Yes.
Big fan of time travel.
Big fan of time travel, and boy. Well,
you've never seen Back to the Future 2.
I've seen Back to the Future 2, just not 3.
Well, I haven't seen one of the
most... If it's got a train, I don't know.
So, anyway.
Yeah. This movie was really interesting because I didn't know how time travel-y he was going to get with it. And boy, he had a lot of fun with the time travel stuff. Very inventive ideas. I don't really want to spoil any of them, so it's sort of hard to say what ideas were so inventive that I really liked. But I did like the fact, I was confused. When I first saw the trailers, I thought, oh, this is great. It's gonna be like 1950s, and that they're gonna be sending people from the future to like 1950s. So it's not like the Joseph Gordon-Levitt time slice was in the future, that was in the past, and then it was—
That's what you thought.
That's
the
what
trailer.
I thought. Right. That is not what the movie is. Yeah. The movie is future and then super future.
Right. But the reason why you think that is because the style of the near future
is noir.
And it's exactly noir, which is 50s. Or they use blunderbusses and pea shooters, and the guns are even western-y
as opposed all that.
To right.
It's not
just style.
Right.
Yes. I mean, I had a blast. I loved it. I thought it was great. It was amazing. I want to watch it 7 times so I can understand all the nuances. He did something amazing with the time travel movie, which was it was extremely complex. It had a lot of inner workings of time travel plots, but I felt like I followed it the entire time and the first time through. A lot of movies that have this time travel intricacy,
Primer,
they work after you see them a couple times and you go, oh, that was happening. But there are moments where, you know, there was a scene right at the beginning of the hell breaking loose,
right,
where he's in his apartment and there's a shot that's heard outside. It's heard briefly, barely even pays attention to it, and then goes about his business. We then later see that happens and what that was. And I have a feeling a lot of people probably didn't pick up on the shot the first time through. And in watching it the second time, you'll go, oh, that was so-and-so doing that thing outside that I know he's doing. You know what I mean? Yeah, what's up?
Your reaction is very, very interesting to me because I think it's indicative of two things that I've heard Rian Johnson say about this. One was he thought of time travel in this movie the way it works in the Terminator movies. It sets up the plot and then it just happens. That's a very simple version of time travel. On the other hand, he hired Shane Carruth, the writer and director of Primer, to work with him on
the intricacies.
Well, Actually, I believe he worked with him on a specific sequence that didn't end up in the movie, but he still was there to guide him.
That's too bad. Where's that?
Yeah.
Give me the DVD extra.
The DVD extra is going to be like, what did I just watch?
So it's interesting that what you took away was a lot of, what was it? In the one hand, simple and I understood it, but yet I saw a lot of complexity in it.
Yeah, maybe what it is a lot of the really specific science fiction time travel choices that you see almost short. I mean, there's almost like little short films that are theories of time travel that happen sort of bing, 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 bing. And so what you think is this, oh my God, so many different time travel things can happen in this world, but really you've seen the way that that one thing works, then the way that this one thing works. And the other thing is Rian Johnson is so great at writing speeches and language that it's so great because the people the people are saying things in, you know, there's a scene where he's talking to his older self and he's like, how does it work? I want to know what's happening to your brain. What's the blah, 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 blah. And he's like, I'm not going to sit here and talk to you for 20 minutes about how time travel works and pull straws out and make diagrams, which is exactly what you would get in the other time travel movies.
Right.
Rather than you would get a character who would say the thing that a logical person would say in the situation, which is, we don't have time to sit here and debate about how time travel works. Let's just say that it works and get the F out of here because bad things are happening.
It's even better than that. It's even better than that because that's exactly what I was going to mention as well. It's even better than that because, yes, you have the scene where he's like talking to the audience and saying, I'm not going to do this, audience. Just come with me. But it's even better than that because that's not just an out that he uses conveniently to push aside your questions. Instead, what he does is, whereas in all the other time travel movies you've ever seen, including the best ones, including Back to the Future, you get the moment where it's, Marty, look at the chalkboard. Marty, look at this. Let me explain to you how the rules work in our movie.
Right.
Here, he not only tells you we're not gonna get that, but instead what he does in its place is he shows you all of the rules working. He establishes the rules by showing you them in practice. So not only does he accomplish establishing how terrifyingly scary the consequences for double-crossing the mob are in this movie, but at the same time shows you what it means to have time travel as your device for getting back at people when you're in this mob in the future. And there's over and over, there are these moments where instead of a character explaining it to you, you see it, you see the ramifications, you see what, there's so many. The thing that blows me away about this movie, and this movie is spectacular. Like, it is his best movie, which is saying a lot because I'm head over heels for his first two films. And it might be my favorite movie of the year. It is so amazing that he manages to mine a genre and a science fiction trope that feels like it has been played out in a lot of ways. And there's not just a couple of new ideas here or a couple of different takes on time travel. It's like overflowing with new ideas.
Yeah, there's almost no old ideas about time travel in this movie.
It is just thing after thing after thing. It's like, how has nobody ever thought of this before? And yet, in addition to that, it is about the most obvious, the most important questions that we have about time travel, about life. It's about time catching up with us all. It's about how we are all finite. It is about the biggest question of time travel of all, anyone would ever ask is, would you go back and stop Hitler?
Yeah.
You know, that's what this is about. And there's so much about life, about love, about relationships, about the span of time, about what would you say to yourself if you had the opportunity, would you understand you at a different time? All those things, and like you said, they're all done in these wonderfully small, he is a brilliant writer of dialogue, and there is some brilliant dialogue in this, but the best moments in this movie are these tiny little visual poems, these little poetic moments of visual storytelling that brought tears to my eyes a couple of times with just how exquisite and beautifully punctuated they are, how short, sweet, and effective they are at communicating the emotional beat that they're trying to do. You know, you'll get Bruce Willis just closing his eyes for a moment and remembering something, and it's just a snippet, but it conveys so much. And on top of all that, just the first third of this movie would be the coolest time travel movie we've seen in a long time.
Yeah.
And it keeps upping the ante and keeps adding new ideas. And every twist, I was on the edge of my seat the entire time. It is a roller coaster of action and excitement and emotional investment. Like, don't do that. Please don't do that. You know, I can't heap enough praise on this movie. I was blown away by it. It is spectacular.
Yeah, and great performances all around, which he usually gets.
I was just gonna say, what did you guys think of, I initially found it interesting that Joseph Gordon-Levitt, of the choice for Joseph Gordon-Levitt to wear the prosthetics to look more like younger Bruce Willis, because a lot of times a great performance sells the younger version of a character. Often in flashbacks in movies, we see a guy who has the same mannerisms as the older, but it's a younger actor not choosing to look like that character, like the older actor. But I actually, after watching the movie, I feel like I understand a little bit more now, because we've never seen the same guy in the room with the same younger guy.
Yeah.
And it's supposed to be like, other than moments back in the future, whatever. But like, it's not. If it was Joseph Gordon-Levitt normal
and Joseph Gordon-Levitt and old
and,
face,
and no, I was gonna say and Bruce Willis, it would have felt like, oh, they're two different characters, right? You wouldn't have seen, like even Bruce Willis has owned the kid, you know? It's like, which is the same kind of thing happening. But no, those are two different actors, and you don't really. This is like, it's so their heat scene is so much more interesting, because they are like, oh no, that's the same guy talking to himself,
right?
Not
like
the same guy talking to another actor, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Really see them as, when Hitman gets upset, you see them as two different characters, whereas this is like, oh no, that's the same
character.
You
also see the progression of his life at a certain point.
Right.
And the transition from Joseph Gordon-Levitt to Bruce Willis isn't as abrupt because of that, because of the blue eyes and the prosthetic, you know what I mean?
There's a bit of a tonal shift halfway through the movie. If you switch main characters. We switch main characters, sort of, but I would say that
it's the same guy.
Yeah, it's more of a. If the beginning of the movie is more of a noir, the last half of the movie is a little bit more of a western.
Yeah.
How did you guys? Did you dig that kind of flick as much as
I
you
did.
Like the beginning? Or
yeah.
Yeah.
I did. I mean, we also get like the best. I mean, regardless of how good Die Hard 5 turns out to be, or 6 or whatever.
Five.
We also get the best Die Hard movie you're gonna see, probably, and we also get. And then you might want to spoiler cam this sentence, just this sentence. We get the best Akira movie you're ever going to see as well. So that said that.
Well, you haven't seen Chronicle yet, but.
Oh, I haven't?
No.
No, I haven't seen Chronicle. Yeah. Is it Akira?
It is Akira.
Oh.
The whole movie is Akira.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, first off, if you're a sci-fi fan, if you're a thriller fan, this is a no-brainer. If you're a fan of sort of witty dialogue and smart ideas in movies that you can really sink your teeth into, I mean, it's a no-brainer. I don't know if there actually is anybody that I would say, meh, you can skip it. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if there's a category of movie lover where I would go,
it is solid
from start to finish. I just couldn't believe that, like, I kind of expected a certain level of quality, and I expected a ride from Rian Johnson because he's so good, but where this goes and the depth of the ideas that he's dealing with and how far he manages to string me along on this journey, and my allegiances are changing, and the roller coaster of this movie is so far and away above anything he's done before and anything almost anybody else is doing. You know, this is Christopher Nolan territory.
Yeah. Yeah,
you know,
it's
really that good.
Looper, see it.
Let's close the loop, guys.
All right, everybody, be sure to stick around for outtakes from this lovely week of taping. But first, we want to thank our sponsor, Jeff Cannata.
Hey, everybody. I'm back to hip you to how you can look cool for a little bit of money.
Hey. That's future speak right there.
Future speak. In the future, you won't have to leave your house to look awesome. In the future, you will be able to buy awesome, sweet, cool apparel, but not pay sticker price. Low prices, not having to leave your house. In the future.
In the future, they won't even know what stickers are.
Exactly.
Stickers for suckers.
Stickers are for suckers. Guess what, folks? The future is now. JackThreads.com, the online shopping destination for dudes.
The future has invisible watches.
The future is?
Gives you everything on the site for up to 80% off because full price is for the Sucway, as I like to say. That's the French version of sucker. They're gonna give you killer contemporary street apparel, accessories, gadgets, all kinds of stuff. There's a whole bunch of brands that they serve, and they are the coolest brands. I'm gonna do a few just at random. Supra, Nixon, Converse, Penguin, The Hundreds, Ben Sherman,
completely busted, random, just randomized, random.
Ben Sherman?
Yeah, it is.
Shopping is just stupid simple. And all the styles on the site are curated. That means they're not just throwing, it's not just the shovelware.
Nope.
It's the best of the best of the coolest of the coolest. There's no buyer's remorse. It's back to school time right now. I mean, it's been a while of back to school, but you know, you're gonna wanna look cool to impress all the ladies.
Yeah, continue going back to school.
Yeah, so go to jackthreads.com/TRS. We'll hook you up. You don't have to be in the waiting list to get into JackThreads, because we'll hook you up. jackthreads.com/TRS. Do it!
The extra S isn't there.
It's true.
For success.
Guys.
Sherman.
Completely
busted,
random. Just randomized. Random.
Oh, yeah, it's great. Oh, hang on a second. Hey, my iPhone 5 is arriving right now.
Wait, what?
I'm not kidding.
Uh-oh.
Hello? thanks. Should you just leave it in front of the door?
Nope.
I'm not home. You can have the manager sign for it, or you can leave it in front of my door.
Nope.
Okay. Okay. Sure will.
Wow.
Sir, are you still there? Is my...
A manager could be calling, an agent could be calling, girlfriend, mom, not answering that phone.
No, we're gonna answer the phone. Yeah. iPhone 5 called.
Yeah,
that's the iPhone
hilarious.
5 called. Did he say he was gonna leave it at the manager's place?
No, he's like, I'm not gonna leave it in front of your door. I was like, please leave it in front of my door. So I'll check to see if the manager's here.
Good luck with that.
Oh man, manager better be there.
Otherwise, and then it's Saturday.
I gotta go, guys.
You can probably chase him down in the car when you're done. You're like, I just need to talk to you, sir. Here's my ID.
So,
what was I saying?
You were right in the middle of brands.
Oh, yeah. I'm just gonna.
Shopping is stupid.
Just say Ben Sherman and then go.
Yeah. Ben Sherman?
Yeah, it is.
Oh, I think my phone did buzz, actually. Before, a while ago.
Your old ass piece of junk phone?
Phantom buzz.
Goes in the garbage. Ugh.
God.
It's so heavy. And
where do you put that extra layer of apps?
I just like had this like, 10 years from now, if we were watching this, and when you say like
you
Beau Frizzle,
more?
That's gonna be like if we watched and you're like, it's mo money, mo problems, right? You
know, it's like 5 years ago us saying FTW after everything.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. But even that doesn't give you the pain yet. Like there will be a pain.
Associated with Frizzle.
Like yeah, like I'm just really of the time.
I'm
like,
prepared for the pain.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, we're watching. Like, what's with our shirts?
Oh God.
What's up with those weird collars that we're wearing?
How come none of us had laser shirts?
Yeah. Oh my God. Okay, is everybody ready?
Hunker down.
Such a random
hunker down squizzle. I'm gonna whisper this one. And Mike could be like, fuck!
What? What, Jeff?
Yeah, just start whispering. Make it even harder. Just start whispering.
This whole one's gonna be like, Jack Threads is the shopping for dudes.
Amazing. We're like, what was that? What was the screaming after you were screaming? Oh, that was Mike. Here we go. Ready?
No. Oh, there's like you're like you dislocated your jaw.
that was his cobra yawn.
Yeah, Dan's gonna eat an entire mouse right now.
Yeah. Semi-path. This is good. We're good now. This is hot. Hot time.
Bus stop.
Go time.
Bus
go
stop
hot.
Reviews.
Go hot.
The bus stop's here.
All right. Whenever you're ready.
The future is now.
Glaven. That's amazing. That's a phone.
Yeah.
Pistol Glaven.
Ooh.